Hebrews chapter 1 is arguably the single most chapter that focuses on Jesus Christ's divinity. In other words, Jesus Christ is God. So strongly than any other New Testament chapter. Now, there's other chapters in the New Testament, such as John chapter 1 and Colossians chapter 1, for example, that are very notable for the display of Jesus as God. It's not as much, though, I believe, as the Old Testament verses that are applied to Christ here in Hebrews chapter 1. Now, as you recall how Hebrews chapter 1 began, we are reminded of how the author brings to light that, we talked about it last Sunday, that intimate and unique relationship between God the Father and God the Son. In verses 2 to 3, again, chapter 1 of Hebrews, we read that Jesus is called the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. In verse 5, we saw how none of the proclamations were said of angels, but of Christ. In verse 6, we saw how the angels are commanded to worship Jesus. In verse 8, we saw how this Old Testament passage, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever," was not pointing to earthly kings or rulers, but ultimately pointing to Christ, the eternal King. Now in verses 10 to 14, the author brings to conclusion of his argument of the superiority of Jesus as the Son of God, and here in context, superiority over the angels, and furthermore, superiority of the new covenant over the old. Now, before we get into the verses, just to lay out some context here, just help us further, when talking about God's attributes, there are two categories, communicable and incommunicable. Communicable and incommunicable attributes. Now, what this means is that there are attributes that God shares with human beings, that's us, to some degree that other creatures don't share at all. Now, these are called God's communicable attributes. So when we speak of God's communicable attributes, we are to think primarily about God's moral attributes. For example, his goodness, his kindness, his love. Now, in one sense, we must never forget that there's a limit of even these attributes because God's love, goodness, and kindness are infinite. Therefore, we can't imitate them on the same level. But nevertheless, because we bear God's image, we are made in God's image, there is a way that we do exhibit these attributes. So while our love will never be identical to the kind of love our Creator has, as God's people, we possess the capacity to do the same. Now, on the other hand, there are attributes that God does not share with human beings or any other creation, but only God exclusively has. Those are incommunicable attributes. For example, only God has omnipotence, omniscience, omnipresence. Only God is considered to be infinity. Only God is self-existent. His self-existence. These are God's incommunicable attributes. And in verses 10 through 12 of today's passage, we see the divine incommunicable attributes that are attributed to the Son. Attributes such as eternity, omnipotence, and immutability. As we begin in verse 10, we see in verse 10, describing the Son creating the universe and all of creation. And we also see in verse 11 of how heaven and earth will perish. In other words, the creator world, the world that we live in, is temporary and will come to its end. Like an old piece of clothing, they're even now wearing out. But Christ will remain. And this eternality of the Son demonstrates his divinity, showing that he shares the same identity as God. And as we read, let's continue now in verse 12. What do we read here? We read in verse 12, like a robe, he, Christ, will roll them up and exchange it for new clothing. Verse 12 is pretty much repeating and emphasizing what was said in verse 11. We see here that creation is compared to a piece of clothing that grows old, like a pair of jeans that just over time and wears out as time passes. Well, to read again, but Christ himself will remain and he will have no end. Christ is eternal and unchanging in contrast to the created world, which is temporary and fading away slowly day by day. Verses 10 through 12 here in Hebrews chapter 1 portrays Christ's divinity and is another Old Testament quote from Psalm chapter 102. Here specifically, verses 25 to 27. Now it's good to look at this Old Testament passage in its original context to get a better understanding of today's passage. Now, if you look at your Bible, for the most part, I believe, there's a subtitle that's there in Psalm 102. And it'll read somewhere along the lines like this: a prayer of one afflicted when he is faint and pours out his complaint before the Lord. So that's the context of Psalm 102, someone lamenting and pouring out his complaints before God. And if you go and look, Psalm 102, there's a first half and then there's a second half. In the first half of Psalm 102, verses 1 through 11 specifically, the writer laments the decaying nature and shortness of life. He laments the opposition that he's getting from his enemies. He laments the weakness and failure of all created things, especially of human beings and human nature. He's lamenting all that in that psalm. And the writer points or attributes this weakness and failure of human nature, of human beings, to sin. What this psalm, Psalm 102, is pointing to how our days pass away, like smoke, like a vapor that's here one day and gone tomorrow, like a wind just blowing past by, is gone. And our bones do stumble and our bones do fall. In context here, the writer seems to be motivated by the destruction of Jerusalem by the Babylonians. And in bitterness of defeat, he eats ashes and he drinks his drink with tears. For us today, while we live here in this passing away world, we too will know the taunts from our enemies. We too will experience the persecution of the enemies that perhaps that we are too even weak to oppose. But in the second half of Psalm 102, the lamenting man lifts his eyes to see God, and there he finds hope, a great hope, a God who keeps and fulfills his covenant promises. Even though all is lost in this life, though extreme difficulty and even death awaits, though the worst tragedy comes, the person who trusts the Lord sees the Lord in his eternal reign of power. He sees the Lord in his unchanging and unchangeable character, and he sees there that hope is found. Though we ourselves, living in this falling away world, may lose much or even everything in this life, perhaps even our own lives, through our faith in God, receive a salvation that is eternal and secure. Now think about that for a second. Lots of times when we think about our salvation, we're thinking, oh, that's great, that's wonderful. And we just think that's just that. If we really stop and think about it, saying to ourselves, wow, I'm saved, is something to think about. We have a salvation in Christ that is eternal and that is secure, come what may in this falling away world. Last Sunday, we saw how the author of Hebrews was arguing for Christ's superiority to the angels and thus the superiority of the new covenant to the old covenant. That contrast is inescapable considering these verses from Psalm 102. So, if these things are true of the Son of God, then he is worthy. He is worthy of our trust. He is worthy of our praise. He is worthy of our devotion to him. With that being said, in contrast, it will be foolish not to turn for our salvation to such a mighty and trustworthy Savior. In light of the New Testament, we must see that these both halves of Psalm 102 that we just went over, I want to encourage you to go and read and go over that on your own in your Bibles, as applying to our Lord Jesus Christ. The first half of Psalm 102, Christ is the afflicted man, pouring out his lament before his Father. It is Christ's voice as he faces and then takes up the cross that we hear him crying out, "For my days pass away like smoke, and my bones burn like a furnace. My heart is struck down like grass and has withered. All the day my enemies taunt me." In his humanity, Jesus knew what it was to have his days cut short. Jesus knew what it was to die too young. Jesus knew what it was to be afflicted and hated by men and by people, and he definitely knew what it meant to be abandoned by even his closest friends, to be alone. He was crucified in shame. He died a cursed death with all the bitterness and all the darkness a man, a person, can ever experience. But now, the second half. Yes, the world may have crucified Christ, and yes, Christ may have experienced all the bitterness and darkness. The Father enthrones him, and they will perish, but Christ will remain. They will all wear out like a garment, like a robe. Christ will roll them up. Like a garment, they will be changed, but Christ is the same, and Christ's years will have no end. The author of Hebrews is proclaiming that the Son is greater than the angels because Christ is the one that created the earth and the heavens. And like a master builder, the Son laid the foundations for the earth. And the heavens, which here represent the sky, the moon, the sun, and the stars, are made by the hands of the Son. And this created work of the Son was accomplished at the beginning. And history began, and the heavens and the earth were created. But as we continue in verse 13, we find another Old Testament passage, and again from the Psalms, specifically Psalm chapter 110, verse 1. And if you go look at Psalm 110, verse 1, you will see exactly that, which is the last Old Testament, quote, used to point to the supremacy of Christ over angels in Hebrews chapter 1. Here, verse 13 shows us the opening words of Psalm 110, and it points to Christ's enthronement. And it aligns with what was said of Christ back in verse 3 of Hebrews chapter 1. Here we see a picture of Christ seated on his throne. It's a picture that comes from the ancient courts where the king sat upon his throne while his servants stood before him to show their submission to him and to show that the king was supreme. Now here also we read to be told, "Sit at my right hand." What that means is that it shows distinguished honor and dignity. It shows rank, it shows power, and it shows authority in the kingdom. Again, no privilege like this was ever given to angels, which the author of Hebrews is trying to get at here in chapter 1. Now, the fact that Jesus is seated on the throne, we saw that in the previous passages, went over that. The fact that Jesus is seated on the throne does not mean that he is inactive. He's just, I don't know, just reclining, you know, pull the lever and just reclining on his throne. No, he is, that doesn't mean that God, that Jesus Christ is not inactive, that he's lazy, or doesn't know what to do. But rather, it means that he is attentively concerned with what is happening to his flock. Being seated, Jesus holds authority over and for the sake of his church. That should bring us comfort. To know that our Lord is busy on our behalf from his heavenly seat. He is active on our behalf. Now, we may never know when Jesus helps us in our time of need or strengthens us in times of weakness. But how many times can we remember those moments? Maybe even right now we can remember those moments where we did receive help through various means and through God's people. While certain things we may never know 100% clearly, what is absolutely clear is that Jesus sends us the Holy Spirit to teach us of him, to enlighten our minds and knowledge of God, to convict us of sin, to renew our wills, and to guide us in the paths of righteousness. And we also know for absolutely certain that Jesus intercedes for us with the Father. He is actively interceding for us, ensuring our acceptance in God's presence, and pleading our every cause from his seat of honor and authority at God's right hand. As Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 said that Jesus opposed the universe by the word of his power, he also opposed our faith by his prayers, intercession for us. Now, if you notice in the second half of verse 13, we read, "Until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." In ancient times, a victorious general or king would place his foot on the neck of a defeated enemy. So then, question is, who are Jesus' enemies that he will eventually put his foot on their necks? 1 Corinthians chapter 15 tells us that it's worldly powers, sin, Satan, death, and the grave. These are Christ's enemies. While Jesus was here on earth and he was ministering here on this earth, he went straight into enemy territory, casting out demons, healing the sick, exposing hypocrisy, humbling the proud, speaking uncompromised truth with grace, all the while calling sinners to repentance and faith. Worldly powers, sin, Satan, death, and the grave are defeated as men and women come to saving faith in Jesus Christ. And in the end, Jesus will have no enemies left standing. Christ our Lord sits on the throne at God's right hand until his enemies become his footstool, and then Christ will reign forever. Then in verse 14, the author concludes by pointing back to angels' purpose here. If you go look in verse 7 of chapter 1 of Hebrews, you'll know what I mean. By contrast, angels do not rule but serve. They are sent by God to carry out God's purposes. In this verse, they are identified as ministering spirits, which again shows their role as God's servants. And their service is for the sake of human beings, for angels do their work for those who are to, as we read here, inherit salvation. And last Sunday, we touched upon the five Old Testament quotes, and now today we have concluded chapter 1 with two more Old Testament quotes that point to the supremacy of Christ, of Jesus Christ as God. I think it's a good way to end this chapter with Jesus seated at God's right hand, because that's where he is now. And will continue to be so, reigning as Lord over all and on behalf of his bride, his church. Christ is a sufficient Savior, worthy of our trust, worthy of our praise, worthy of our lives to him. These verses from Hebrews chapter 1, from the Word of God, give us great reasons to trust Christ as our Savior and Lord. In verse 10, we have a Savior who was there from eternity. Christ is a solid rock on which we can stand assured and secured. And yet he came into this world as one of us so that he could make a place for us in eternity. Even now, he opens a door for all who would come to God through him. In verse 11, we have a Savior who holds ultimate power, overcoming all the enemies that go against him, enemies that also enslave and hurt us even today. And it was through the greatest weakness that Jesus lifted the heaviest burden, the burden of our sins. Was because he submitted to the Father's will to go to the cross that God raised him to the position of glory and authority. And now from God's right hand, he can and does help us in time of need and saves us unto eternal life. And in verse 12, we have a Savior who is unchanging and unchangeable. That's good. That's good for us. And so we may always turn to him with confidence for salvation. Jesus is never going to change his mind about us or perhaps even lose his power to save us. Now, if all this is true, what can we need or can be found that can be found in Jesus Christ? For those who are here today, do you need pardon for your sin? There he is, Christ, who is exalted and know. Look to Christ. He is exalted and know that God has accepted the sacrifice of Christ's blood on your behalf. Do you need reconciliation to God? There he is, at God's right hand, interceding for you and offering his perfect work on the cross as the ground of your acceptance. Do you need newness of life, a new heart or new strength to continue following Christ? There he is on his heavenly throne who sends mighty resources to you, even angels perhaps, to help. But even much, much better, as we talked about, he sends his Holy Spirit to work within you. Do you have troubles? Do you have difficult decisions that are coming up that you need to make? Do you have choices that worry you or problems that cause you fear and anxiety? Well, look to Christ, seated in his throne in power, a Savior who cares for you with wisdom and love, a Savior who cares for you with power and a purpose for your future. I pray that these truths lead you to trust in him more and more and more, that you glorify him more and more and more and live for him more and more and more? Do you fear death? Christ is reigning now until even that last enemy, death, will be conquered. Because he reigns victorious, death will have no hold on you, but death only does what? It only ushers you. It takes you into glory. It's not the end. With these truths, I believe that we are able to live until we meet God in eternity in the now. Right? That's the fact that we're in. That's reality. We're living here right now in this fallen world, passing away world, with pains, with difficulties, with trials. Whether that comes to us or that we inflict that on others. With these truths, though, we are then able to live until we meet God in eternity, in the now. That's why we must not be tempted away to look away from the truths of what God says in his word. That's why we must never be swayed or be tempted to think that being in God's word is a waste of time, or that being in God's word is not very practical in my life. No. The way you live now all comes to what you believe to be true. The way you live now all comes to what you believe to be true. So do you believe what God's word says to you is true? Do you believe what God's word says to you about Christ and the truths about him is true? So instead of living according to what we feel or what we experience, or to what this world and this culture says to us, may we instead, church, listen to the voice of God and his word more and more. Let's take some time to pray in response to what God has, I pray, has spoken to us this morning. For those joining us for the first time, or perhaps it's been a while, we're simply going before the God in prayer. Whatever it is, perhaps that God has placed on your heart to, from hearing from his word, specifically in today's passage, I want to encourage you to not just let that slip away or say to yourself, oh, that's not really big of a deal, or I don't really need to pray about that, or I'm not sure if God will even listen to that. No, you can pray and go to the Lord with it. Whatever it might be. Perhaps it's a question. Perhaps you're asking for clarity and understanding. The Lord will answer that. Maybe you're convicted of sin and you want to confess that to the Lord. He will hear you. But perhaps you're praying for others, maybe even yourself. The Lord will hear your prayer. But whatever it is, would you go before God and pray to him? Let's take some time to pray in church. Father God, thank you, Lord, for speaking to us through your word this morning. Lord, as we're reminded, or perhaps hearing for the first time, of who you are, God. You, Lord Jesus Christ, who is now, even now, reigning as you are seated in the right hand of God on that eternal throne, active and busy on behalf of your church, of your people, interceding for us so that we are able to come before the presence of holy and perfect God. Not on our grounds or what we have done to access that, or to allow us to do so. But Lord, on the grounds of Jesus Christ, what you have done on that cross, and the blood that washed away and continually washes away our sin, so that we can have that relationship, that we can have that joy in the presence of our Heavenly Father. Lord, thank you. And God, you also know all the things that we're going through, contemplating, struggling over. You know our hearts, you know our situations, you know our circumstances. Perhaps things that we haven't shared with one another. But God, you know it all. And you call us to look to you. You provide us with help and comfort. You have given us your people, the church, to come alongside and go together on this journey together in this life. And Lord, like the man in the song, we see lots of different things in this world that confuses us and gives us pain. But God, help us, Lord, to lift our eyes to you, Lord Jesus Christ, and to see that God, Jesus, you are still seated, that you're on your throne. So help us, O Lord, as we live this life in sacrifice, in humble obedience, and devotion to you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray all these things. Amen.